तो यार मजे की स्टोरी लगी है,
बड़ी अच्छी लगी,
काफी अच्छी अच्छी इन्फॉर्मेटिव वीडियो थी, लंबी थी लेकिन मजे की थी। तो इन्होंने बहुत सी डीप बातें बताई हैं जो आपने वीडियो में देख ली होगी, बरा लगा मैं उन्होंने क्या रिवाइज करना, लेकिन मजे की
वीडियो थी,
मजे की
इन्फॉर्मेटिव वीडियो थी।
बांग्लादेश वालों, इंडिया वालों, पाकिस्तान वालों, बाकी और किसी कंट्री से देखते हैं, नेपाल से देखते हैं, चलो देखते हैं, जहाँ जहाँ से भी देखते हैं भाई,
जहाँ जहाँ से देखते हैं,
तो कैसे हाल चाल, सब फिट हैं,
सब फिट हैं।
तो बाकी बरा जो है ना, हमें ऐसी वीडियो सजेस्ट करते रख रहे हैं, अच्छी अच्छी हम देखेंगे इंशाल्लाह जरूर। अभी आज की वीडियो बताओ
यार, आज ना आज मैंने आर्टिकल पढ़ा था कि बांग्लादेश भी ना न्यूक्लियर पावर बनने के लिए कोशिश कर रहा है, वो भी उस चीज पर काम कर रहा है।
वीडियो का टाइटल है न्यू सुपर पावर इज इमर्जिंग एंड इट्स नॉट चाइना,
इट्स नॉट चाइना, ओके। आपको वीडियो देख के पता चल
जाएगा, देख लेते हैं कौन है, कहां से निकल आया,
बांग्लादेश की यार इकोनॉमी भी 8.75%
से प्लस है,
8 के राउंड बाउंड है, और नंबर वन है एशिया में, बड़ी
फास्टली ग्रो करके
इंडिया सेकंड नंबर पे है, और इंडिया की है 7 point something,
चाइना
की कितनी है,
चाइना की पता नहीं है यार,
हमारे
फिर इंस्टा के लिंक्स नीचे होते हैं, वहाँ पे आप हमें प्राइवेट में कुछ भी सजेस्ट
कर सकते हैं,
तो उसका इशू नहीं है,
प्राइवेट भी कर सकते हैं अगर आपने पब्लिकली करना है,
नीचे कमेंट में आके जरूर बताएं, जो भी आपने मतलब वीडियो क्रिएशन दिलवाना जो भी है, बहरहाल वीडियो स्टार्ट करते हैं,
हमेशा की तरह काउंटिंग के साथ स्टार्ट करते हैं, 3, 2, 1 स्टार्ट।
China's transformation is giving a boost to many emerging economies and potentially even one real superpower. While it is moving its manufacturing to the markets with low labor and raw material costs, the massive investments are creating favorable conditions for these countries to rise from poverty. And the COVID-19 crisis is only speeding up this process. Take the case of Bangladesh. Bangladesh, in the recent past, has quietly achieved what none of the Asian nations could, an average growth of 8%. Yes, you heard that right. Outstripping major economies of China and India and other South Asian tigers, Bangladesh has made its way to the top spot. Once living in subsequent military or military-backed regimes that perpetuated poverty, religious fundamentalism, and corruption, this country managed to become a development model. At the center of the growth story is the nation's textile industry, with 4,560 operational garment factories involved in exports today, supplying retailers such as Walmart and Marks and Spencer. The nation has surged ahead of India vis-a-vis market share and become second only to China. The $34 billion sector is the backbone of Bangladesh's economy, contributing over 80% to the country's export revenue and representing 13% of GDP. Bangladesh beat its competitors with dirt-cheap labor. It is said they have the lowest labor cost in Asia at $101 per month, and zero import duties on its garments by the European Union and other developed nations. This preferential duty is enjoyed by many underdeveloped nations to enable their economies to grow, while developing nations like India attract a 9 to 10% import duty. Such advantages, alongside recent geopolitical tensions, as the trade war between China and the US, has also helped attract record foreign direct investment. The government has wisely diversified into other industries as well, and as a result, the services sector of microfinance and computing have boomed. Together, the two now make up a substantial portion of the nation's GDP. Bangladesh also exports technology products worth nearly $1 billion every year, with government planning to take it to $5 billion by 2021. An advanced pharmaceutical industry worth $3 billion is another feather in its cap. Mostly homegrown, the Bangladeshi pharmaceutical companies produce high-quality anti-cancer drugs that are exported to 151 countries. All of this was greatly supported by the investment coming from China. Bangladesh and China turned their relationship into a strategic partnership in 2016. And in recent years, Chinese investment in the South Asian country has risen rapidly. China has pumped more money into Bangladesh than any other country over the past couple of years. Bangladesh saw a record inflow of FDI in 2018, with the country attracting $3.6 billion, 68% higher than in the preceding year, according to a report by the UN Conference on Trade and Development. China alone accounts for almost a third of this investment, worth over $1 billion. Bangladesh now increasingly relies on Chinese money to achieve its ambitious target of producing 24,000 megawatts of power by 2022. The Padma Bridge, a major road rail project across the Padma River, is being built by the China Major Bridge Engineering Company.
China.
And China's Exim Bank is providing $3 billion for the construction of the rail link accompanying the bridge. Bangladesh has announced an ambitious plan to set up 100 special economic zones by 2030. Many Chinese companies appear interested in investing in these zones. While the economic fallout of the coronavirus outbreak will undoubtedly be most severe in China, the negative effects of the pandemic will not be confined by the Great Wall. After all, China is the world's manufacturing hub, and the ripple effect of shutdowns across the country is already leading to supply constraints in various industries all around the globe. According to data published by the UN Statistics Division, China produced 28% of global manufacturing output in 2018, over 10 points ahead of the US, which used to have the world's largest manufacturing sector until China overtook it in 2010. With $4 trillion value added by the Chinese manufacturing sector in 2018, manufacturing accounted for nearly 30% of the country's total economic output. China is currently undergoing a transition from an export and investment-driven economy to one that is consumption and services-oriented. Nonetheless, fixed investment remains a key driver of China's economic growth for the moment. In 2015, fixed investment steadily rose to a new high of $5.7 trillion US, accounting for around 50% of total GDP, thanks to the government's strong push for infrastructure investment. This trend is likely to continue in the coming years as urbanization moves ahead and new government initiatives are rolled out, such as the Belt and Road, Beijing Tianjin Hebei City Cluster, Yangtze River Economic Belt, and International Industrial Capacity Cooperation Initiatives. By 2030, services are expected to rise further to around 70% of GDP, and China's rising middle class could generate a consumption market of $6 trillion US, the largest in the world. Meanwhile, China remains one of the most attractive destinations for FDI, providing valuable technologies and management skills to nurture China's modern industries. The rapid rise of Chinese science and technology is more impressive even than such well-known tech success stories as South Korea and Singapore. As China moved from the world's factory to one of its tech powers, the Chinese government pumped money, sent its students around the world, developed a series of master plans, boosted patenting, and took a progressive stance towards changing the whole science, technology, and innovation system. China has turned into an international challenger in fast-growing high-tech areas such as artificial intelligence, the Internet of Things, nanotechnology, biotechnology, quantum computing, and big data. The UK Research and Innovation Agency projects that China will overtake the US in 2022 as the number one nation for R&D investment. As China moves up the value chain, more and more Chinese companies choose to directly acquire foreign brands, technologies, and market networks. Since last June, 33 Chinese companies have informed of their plans to set up or expand production abroad, according to data compiled by the Nikkei Asian Review. Almost 70% of these 33 companies cited Vietnam as their preferred destination, while the remainder chose Cambodia, India, Malaysia, Mexico, Serbia, and Thailand. Competitive wages are not the only thing attracting investors to these countries, but also sourcing cheaper raw materials, reducing labor costs, and avoiding the tariff barrier. A skilled, well-educated workforce, good infrastructure, and a strong network of free trade agreements, including being part of the Asian Free Trade Area and EU-Vietnam FTA, were also factors, according to Rajiv Biswas, a Singapore-based economist at IHS Markit. New Chinese FDI in Vietnam, based on approved projects, swelled 5.6-fold on the year to $1.56 billion between the start of 2019 and May 20. Thailand has also seen an upswing in Chinese capital inflows. In Q1 2019, approved FDI doubled to $933 million, Thai government data shows. A Nomura Holdings report named Vietnam as the biggest beneficiary of the trade war, with an economic boost equivalent to 7.9% of its projected 2019 GDP through the Q1 2019. Taiwan ranked second with a much smaller 2.1% gain, while Chile came in third at 1.5%. Other markets benefiting from the Chinese investment strategy are African countries. Africa is the region of the world with the least inflows and, given their population trends and the current level of development, clearly with the largest needs. This itself justifies a keen interest of China's investor role in Africa. China is politically motivated to invest in Africa because the continent represents a prime opportunity for China to significantly expand its global presence and influence. The IMF recently declared Africa the world's second fastest growing region, and many are predicting that it is well on its way to becoming a $5 trillion economy, as household consumption is expected to increase at a 3.8% yearly clip to $2.1 trillion by 2025. The bulk of China's investment or lending is directed towards China's strategic objectives, namely securing access to resources and using China's excess capacity in construction and transportation. Africa is the fastest growing region population-wise, but China's FDI into Africa is creating fewer jobs per unit of investment on average. So, for China to be successful in its investment strategy in Africa, it will need to move from focusing its investment on natural resources and infrastructure to manufacturing, which is more labor intensive. In the meantime, foreign corporations are also looking towards emerging markets to offset their dependency of China. Samsung, closing their Chinese plants, culminated its decade-long strategy to diversify the risks of its manufacturing bases, according to an executive at the South Korean company. Lured by cheaper labor costs and huge tax breaks, Samsung built its first smartphone plant in Vietnam's Bac Ninh province in 2008 for $2.5 billion, and another in the country's Thái Nguyên province in 2013 for $5 billion. Most of the value that Chinese phone factories add is in low-skilled manual assembly, meaning that rising labor costs have eroded China's competitive advantage, said Wang Weiping, professor of economics at Renmin University in Beijing. China's nominal wage jumped 44% to $876 per month in the 5 years to 2017, according to data from the International Labor Organization. Significantly higher versus 30% rise in Vietnam, 28% in Malaysia, and 11% in Mexico during the same period. Rising costs had been encouraging companies to move overseas even before the trade war, according to analysts. Indeed, China has had a going out policy encouraging such moves since 2001, but few companies felt an urgent need to pursue it due to the huge market at home. American gadget makers, including Google, Fitbit, GoPro, and iRobot, have moved to diversify their manufacturing beyond China within 2018 in favor of Vietnam, Thailand, and Mexico. Google and Microsoft are also accelerating efforts to shift production of their new phones, personal computers, and other devices from China to Southeast Asia amid the worsening coronavirus outbreak. with factories in Vietnam and Thailand expected to be the beneficiaries. With all the investment going into the growing economies, not surprising that in 30 years, most of the world's largest economies will be those that are emerging today, surpassing current behemoths, such as the US, Japan, and Germany. Brexit, coronavirus, and trade tariffs may be making economic headwinds, but despite immediate challenges, the world economy is projected to keep growing at a rapid pace over the next few decades. In fact, by 2050, the global market is projected to double its current size, even as the UN forecasts the world's population will only grow by a modest 26%. According to the World in 2050 report by PwC, in 30 years, 6 of the 7 of the world's largest economies will be today's emerging economies, surpassing the US, dropping from 2nd to 3rd, Japan, dropping from 4th to 8th, and Germany, dropping from 5th to 9th. Even relatively smaller economies like Vietnam, the Philippines, and Nigeria will see huge leaps in their respective rankings over the next 3 decades, according to the report. The largest movers over the next 35 years are projected to be Nigeria, Vietnam, and Pakistan, and to lesser extent, Bangladesh and the Philippines. All these emerging countries tend to benefit from their youthful and fast-growing working-age populations, boosting domestic demand and output. However, growth is driven even more by real GDP per capita growth, suggesting capital investment and technological progress will deliver real labor productivity-enhancing benefits. For these countries to realize this potential, growth needs to be supported by sustained economic reforms, strengthening macroeconomic fundamentals, institutions, and, crucially, mass education to ensure their rapidly growing working populations contribute productively to long-term economic growth. If they cannot do this, it could be a cause of political instability. Still, China is and will remain the largest economy in the world. The Asian behemoth has seen massive economic gains over the past decade, but economists promise that it is just the tip of the iceberg for what the future holds. The changes are attracting a brand new set of entrepreneurs and others looking for financial opportunity amid the seemingly unstoppable growth. The world's second most populous country, India, is expected to see massive growth over the next 3 decades, averaging 5% growth in GDP per year, making it one of the fastest growing economies in the world. By 2050, India is projected to be the world's second largest economy, overtaking the US, and generate 15% of the world's total GDP. Currently, analysts believe India has been unable to capitalize on the trade war because a lack of scale, poor infrastructure, and tough land and labor laws limit India's attractiveness. In sporting goods manufacturing, for example, few local manufacturers have succeeded in attracting international stature, and many are struggling to compete with long-standing competitors in Pakistan and with newer manufacturing centers in Asia that have emerged as favored locations for international sports brands. Prime Minister Narendra Modi's decision in November 2019 not to join the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, a China-backed Pan-Asian trade deal involving 15 countries, raised controversies. Some applauded the move, arguing that membership would have opened up India's markets to a flood of cheap Chinese imports. Others warned that India's manufacturers would find it harder to enter global supply chains if the country did not join trade blocs. India's government has taken several actions to boost manufacturing exports. In September 2019, it cut corporate taxes from 25% to 15% for new manufacturing companies that incorporated from October, levying the effective rate of 17%, one of the lowest in the region. These should put India on par with rivals such as Singapore. Another notably successful campaign is the Prime Minister's Make in India initiative, which promises manufacturers everything from financial incentives to less red tape and intellectual property protection. They, in turn, can take advantage of India's young workforce, low prices, and enormous domestic market. Under Mr. Modi, brands such as Apple and Xiaomi have increased production in India, while Samsung has invested the world's largest smartphone plant near New Delhi. Still, these measures have room for improvement, as manufacturing as a share of Indian GDP has stagnated at 15%, despite Mr. Modi's aim to increase it to 25% and FDI into manufacturing. $8 billion during the year to March 2019 is lower than in 2015. Among the complaints are that productivity remains low and that, despite the government's investments, infrastructure such as roads and power supply are inadequate. Other areas that require addressing are labor and land acquisition laws that make establishing and expanding factories prohibitive. Mr. Modi's government has sought to address these and other concerns, with India climbing from 140th place in the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business rankings to 63rd. And probably the most important, to be a 21st century world power, India should become a permanent member of the UN Security Council in a short time frame. One of those aspirational goals was, is, and will remain permanent membership of the Security Council because we feel by any present-day calculus we would qualify, says India's permanent representative at the UN, Syed Akbaruddin. China, with its veto power, however, has been stonewalling India's efforts to become permanent members for years, pointing out lack of consensus, even though the other four, US, UK, France, and Russia, have backed New Delhi's membership. With all being said, the only country that has a real shot at becoming the next superpower economy is India. So please, let us know your thoughts in the comments down below. Will India achieve the new superpower status? Hit like and share buttons and subscribe to our channel for
Okay, जी guys, video यहाँ पे होगी end. काफी मजे की और काफी informative video थी यार.
बहुत अच्छी थी.
मैंने सोचा था ये सिर्फ बांग्लादेश या इंडिया से related सिर्फ होगी.
मुझे भी ऐसा.
ठीक है ना, क्योंकि मैं suggest में आजकल बांग्लादेश वालों ने की है. तो लेकिन इसमें video में तो इन्होंने जो है ना
बांग्लादेश
का बहुत कम बात की, लेकिन की है
मोस्टली
उन्होंने चाइना की बात की और पूरी दुनिया की, मतलब बात की
और इंडिया की भी बात की.
इंडिया की तो भाई उन्होंने कह दिया सुपर पावर बनने वाला 2050 में.
सेकंड नंबर पे आएगा इंडिया.
इंडिया सेकंड नंबर पे, इकोनॉमी इसकी सेकंड नंबर पे होगी, यूएसए से ऊपर चली
जाएगी, यूएसए को ओवरटेक करेगा.
और फर्स्ट नंबर पे उन्होंने उस वक्त इसकी क्या चाइना चाइना उस वक्त पहले नंबर भी रहेगा
2050 में. चाइना सबसे,
अच्छा चाइना अभी भी उन्होंने पहले नंबर भी बताया, कौन
पूरी आरबी में भी नंबर वन होगा.
ओके 2050 में भी चाइना अपनी पोजीशन पे ही रहेगा, लेकिन इंडिया जो है वो नीचे से ऊपर, यूएसए से भी ऊपर चला जाएगा, सेकंड पे आ जाएगा. ये जो है ना इसमें जो है ना
नाइजीरिया भी उन्होंने मेंशन किया,
सारे कंट्रीज भी यार
नाइजीरिया यार.
उन्होंने मेन पता क्या इसमें फोकस किया, उन्होंने कहा कि जो कोरोना की वजह से चाइना से कंपनीज जा रही हैं, तो ये बाकी कंट्रीज के पास उन्होंने बहुत अच्छा मौका है कि इन्वेस्टर्स को खींचे इस तरफ. जैसे उन्होंने बताया कि सैमसंग निकलने की कोशिश कर रहा है, गूगल निकलने की कोशिश कर रहा है. इसके अलावा आपको पता है कि एप्पल जो है ना वो सारी जो है ना एग्जाम्पल जो है वो चाइना में हो.
अच्छा,
इसकी वजह क्या,
रीजन क्या?
रीजन ये है कि जो सबसे चीप कॉस्ट में लेबर्स मिलते हैं ना उनको,
अच्छा
वो चाइना में मिल रहे हैं एप्पल को. ठीक है ना,
सही
सही. इस वजह से जो है ना बहुत सस्ते में काम उनका लग रहा है, और वो सारे फोन ही जो है ना, आप जो भी आईफोन लें उसको पता होता है एग्जाम्पल इन चाइना.
अच्छा,
ठीक है ना,
सही.
चलो बनता वो अमेरिका में कैलिफोर्निया में, लेकिन असेंबल यहाँ पे होता है क्योंकि यहाँ पे लेबर सस्ती है.
लेबर सस्ती,
तो अभी मुझे एप्पल का नहीं पता कि वो यहाँ से निकल रहे हैं नहीं, लेकिन ये सुना है कि ये अपना प्लांट इंडिया में लगा रहे हैं, इंडिया वालों को फिर वहाँ से
इंडिया में लगा लिया. सैमसंग ने,
सैमसंग नहीं एप्पल की बात है,
एप्पल
वहाँ फिर उनको जाना 20% डिस्काउंट पे, मतलब सस्ता मिलेगा आईफोन. और सैमसंग का यार ये बड़ी खुशी हुई सुन के यार, कि उन्होंने अपना प्लांट पहले ही लगाया
और इंडिया में. हाँ, मैन्युफैक्चर्ड हो रहा है, असेंबल भी इंडिया में हो रहा
है. बैंगलोर का सुना था, बैंगलोर में इनका कुछ है, तो मेरे ख्याल वो प्लांट इनका बैंगलोर में होगा.
बैंगलोर में गूगल के,
गूगल के
नहीं, गूगल की बहुत
बड़ी आप हमें बताया जरूर के
हेडक्वार्टर में
दोनों का, गूगल और इसका सैमसंग का, किन सिटीज
में इंटरव्यूज वगैरह भी बैंगलोर में होते हैं.
तो यार मजे की स्टोरी लगी है, काफी अच्छी इन्फॉर्मेटिव वीडियो थी, लंबी थी लेकिन मजे की थी. तो इन्होंने बहुत सी डीप बातें बताई हैं जो अपनी वीडियो में देख ली होगी, बड़ा लगा मैं उन्हें क्या रिवाइज करना, लेकिन मजे की
वीडियो थी, मजे की इन्फॉर्मेटिव वीडियो थी.
ठीक है, और उसमें इन्होंने बताया बांग्लादेश भी बहुत तेजी से ग्रो करेगा,
ग्रो करेगा इकोनॉमी बहुत. साउथ एशिया में सबसे,
साउथ एशिया में चाइना सबसे ज्यादा इन्वेस्टमेंट बांग्लादेश में कर रहा है, ये चीज उन्होंने बताई, इसलिए बांग्लादेश काफी मतलब तेजी से ग्रो कर रहा
है, इसके लिए लेबर कॉस्ट बहुत कम है बांग्लादेश. $101 पर मंथ चल रहा है,
बिल्कुल
ऐसे एवरेज. तो ठीक है भाई, फाइबर में भी सेकंड नंबर पे बांग्लादेश है, के फर्स्ट नंबर
हां सेकंड पे मैंने सुना सेकंड पे हमने उसके रिएक्शन दिया था उसने बताया था सेकंड पे शायद
थर्ड में पाकिस्तान फर्स्ट पे इंडिया तो गाइस वीडियो लंबी हो रही है
वीडियो एंड करते हैं वैसे ही लंबी हो गई यार वीडियो एंड करते हैं भाई उम्मीद है आपको पसंद आई होगी वीडियो
सब्सक्राइब कीजिएगा लाइक कीजिएगा
इतनी देर हमने वीडियो देखी देखी और आपको दिखाई है देख रहे हैं सब्सक्राइब करें भाई सब्सक्राइब करें तो बरल यहीं पे जाना अपने रिएक्शन एंड करते हैं आप मिलते हैं बहुत जल्द अपने नेक्स्ट वीडियो में तब तक रखें अपना ख्याल टेक केयर अल्लाह हाफिज़।